How does the standard Chinese work week stack up against the rest of the world? According to a study by the Organization for Economic Cooperation, Turkey actually works the longest week in the world, posting almost 50 hours every single week. South Korea has been working to encourage a better work-life balance, but the average there, worker there still spends 45 hours every single week. In Mexico, it's 43. You go north to the U.S. and Canada, and that number drops to around, surprisingly, 37. Now, the French have had a reputation for the short weeks, but the study says from the OECD that their European neighbors in Germany actually clocks the fewest number of weekly hours in the world. Look at this. 26 hours a week. That comes out to just a little more than actually 5 hours a day. So don't all of you go move there right away. Now, for more of the global working conditions, we spoke to Jon Messenger with the International Labor Organization.
I mean, what you're really talking about, these excessively long working hours, and we at the ILO would define that as being more than 48 or 50 hours a week, we know that they have really major negative effects. And the effects operate through fatigue and also through stress. But really, the main effects you see are effects on health, for example, cardiovascular diseases, gastrointestinal disorders, even mental health problems, but also effects on work-life balance as well. People have a much harder time balancing their work and personal life. And finally, they actually become less productive.
Is it up to the employee to say something, or is it up to the company to perhaps be more observant to ensure that doesn't happen?
Well, I mean, obviously, individuals can only do so much, particularly if they're concerned about keeping their jobs. It depends, obviously, on their level of job security, how much security they have, whether they can speak out or not. It also depends on the kinds of managers they have. We know that that has an effect. That's well shown in the research. But companies really would do themselves a favor to take these issues more seriously, to not only establish policies, because many companies have policies, but to make sure that they're followed, to make sure they're enforced, to make sure that managers actually consider their workers' individual needs, their personal lives, and realize that that has an effect on their performance. You know, it has an effect also on whether or not they choose to stay with the company. A lot of times workers vote with their feet simply by leaving. They're either absent more or they simply walk out. Staff turnover goes up, and that obviously has negative effects on your bottom line because you've got to go out, find other people, train them, and get them productive. So this is good for business to take this more seriously. So I think companies really do have a responsibility to try to do more about this issue.
I wanted you to elaborate. How do you measure worker productivity? Because some would say if you worked 100 hours a week, you're very productive if you're actually building something. But if you're thinking about something, that's a different story.
Well, I mean, if you're talking about productivity, you also have to think about whether you're talking about the total amount that you can produce or whether you're talking about how efficient you are, which means how much you can produce per hour of work. Sure, you can work many, many hours and you can get a little bit more output and less output over time, and you can have major negative effects. You know, or you can be more efficient, you can work fewer hours, like, for example, not only in France, people talk a lot about France, but also in countries like Germany, the Netherlands. In fact, Germany and the Netherlands even have shorter working hours than the French do. And you have to think about not only how many hours a week you work, but how much time off you get, how much paid vacation you have. For example, in the U.S., there's no right to paid holidays, there's no right to paid vacations at all. I mean, companies might give you 2 or 3 weeks, but there's no requirement. The U.S. is, in fact, one of the very few countries in the world that doesn't provide any minimum amount of paid vacation in national law.
4 days a week. Does that make any sense to you?
I think it makes sense, yeah. I think shorter hours makes a lot of sense. 4 days a week instead of five, but of course, in a lot of countries, you're talking about more than five. You're talking about 6 hours, you're talking about 6 days a week. You're talking maybe about 7 days a week, like you were saying, for example, for some workers in places like China and other Asian countries. We know, for example, places like Hong Kong, Singapore, Korea, we have very long working hours, at least 6 days a week normally. Now, the Koreans are trying to push those down, trying to move to a five-day week. So I think it does make sense to try to cut working hours. But whether it's 4 days or however you arrange those hours, you ought to think about the individual's needs in terms of how you arrange those hours and give them some flexibility in terms of how those hours are scheduled so people can work the hours when they're most productive. Sort of power hours, I guess you could call them.
You see different different types of work conditions around the world. And I want to talk about just countries in this particular instance. I know you're in Switzerland.
Yeah.
Some people say the French have the best working sort of environment in the world. In your opinion, who does have the best working environment and why?
That's a tough question. I think there's a number of countries that probably could qualify for that. I would point probably first and foremost to Nordic countries, countries like Denmark, Sweden, also the Netherlands as well. These countries tend to have a real strong respect for work-life balance, for personal life. You get a lot of time off. The people tend to work very hard when they're working and produce a lot when they're working. They have very high rates, for example, of hourly productivity, which I just mentioned. So I would say probably the Nordic countries are near the top of the list. The Netherlands, too, is pretty high up there. And the hours are very short, generally. But as I say, the production, the output, is quite high. And the standard of living is high as a result.
As the economy recovers around the world, and that's even debatable as well, but it's certainly gotten a lot better in the last couple of years, does it allow for employees perhaps a little bit more leeway to speak up because they're maybe a little less afraid of their jobs? Tell us about the relationship between the economy and sort of worker rights and workers' happiness, I guess, on the job.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. I think the relationship, you know, the closer you are basically to full employment, the less unemployment you have, you know, the less workers are afraid of losing their jobs or that they think that they can find another job very quickly, the more they are willing to speak up. And the more they are willing to do what I just said, which is to vote with their feet and simply leave a company if they feel that the situation is intolerable. You know, but when you have high levels of unemployment, you know, when you have real fear, you know, that you won't be able to find another job, of course, long-term unemployment rates are very high around the world, including in the U.S. When you have that, well, people are going to be much less likely to speak up, and they're going to just try to find a way to get through it, to tough their way through it. And that's really not good for themselves. Yes, of course, it has negative effects on them, but it also will affect the companies as well,
yeah,
even if they don't realize it.